Good afternoon, everybody. We are Team PASL, and we are now presenting our project Pushing Athletes to Safe Limits. But what do we mean with the word safe limits? In recent years, many studies have been conducting on traumatic brain injuries that are a specific head injury that occur due to many causes, including car accident, falls, and sport, and traumas during sport activities. But this kind of injuries can be can bring severe damages to the brain functionality and structure, as we can see from these fMRI images that shows how the neural activity of a study group of athletes has decreased at the end of the sporting season, while they present a quite normal activity at the beginning of the sporting season. And these issues is becoming more and more important in athletes' world. In particular, high concerns regards athletes who participate in contact sports and that are at risk for repetitive head traumas. In this video, we can see how head impact happens in different situations, in cycling, in American football, and in ice hockey. And the last video will present a shortcut from the last Will Smith movie in order to highlight the importance of this issue also for public opinion. So we are now able to present the identified stakeholders that we identified during our project. The first stakeholder is obviously the athlete world, because athletes are interested in preserving their own health. Then we have team coaches and sponsors that are also interested in preserving their athlete's health. Then we have the medical personnel that is interested in increasing and improving the instruments and methods that are available for them in order to identify the proper diagnosis and prognosis for their patient. And finally, the last stakeholder is the governments that are interested and want to promote and enhance a better and safer sport environment. Considering the previous stakeholder analysis, we can now list the two fundamental requirements that our solution must present. The first requirement is providing an increased amount of information about head impacts in terms of intensity, duration, and localization of the hit. The second requirement is providing instead the protection to the head that during sports activities and performances. But whatever the solution will be, it should not interfere or limit the athlete's sports performances. And nowadays, the traditional method used in order to protect head is represented by the helmet. Because of that, we started our state of art analysis focusing on the usage of helmets and on the existing standards for the construction and commercialization of helmets in different countries and for different sports. And we found that all the standards take into account only impacts that occur with a high level of acceleration, but they almost completely neglect lower intensity impacts, but that can happen with more frequently instead of higher impact, higher intensity impacts. Because of that, the modern standards, the current standards, are not don't allow us to say that they can produce a product that can avoid completely the creation of traumatic brain injuries or concussion, because concussion and brain injuries are more linked with those kind of impacts that are lower but more frequent, and that usually occurs in sports like in contact sports like American football or hockey. And according to a biomedical literature analysis, we found that the acceleration magnitude of the impact is not the only important parameter that we have to take into account, but also the duration of the impact is another valid and important parameter that we have to consider, because the combination of these two parameters can help us in identifying and distinguishes between dangerous and not dangerous impacts for the brain that can produce brain damages and concussions. We try to find in the market some existing solution that have a step forward the traditional protective function of the helmet that can give further information about head impacts. The first solution we found was the shock box, that is an additional equipment that can be attached on the external surface of the helmet and that can give information about helmet impacts. But it's not applicable to to any kind of sport helmet. Then we analyzed the Riddle system. This is another efficient device able to identify dangerous impact. But also in this case, this solution is suitable only for American football. Because there are some solutions in the USA, in the US, that are more connected with traditional American sports like hockey or football, we found that there is a lack of solution instead in the European market and for sports that are more popular in Europe, like skiing or cycling. Because of that, we wanted to create a product that can be efficient for detecting impacts in all these kind of sports. And we want to insert this product inside the European market. Furthermore, we found that the previously explained solution constituted in an additional equipment for the helmet that has to be attached on the external part on the inner part of the helmet. But because of that, we want to create an embedded system. We want to insert inside the helmet an electronic sensing system that is able to detect and monitor the head impact that occurs during sport activities. So we listed a series of the main characteristics that our solution must have. First of all, we wanted a device that is able to work in different modalities according to the different necessities that coming from different sports. Secondly, we want that our device can give accurate measurements of the impact parameters, and because of that, we thought about the usage of MEMS sensors that are accurate, but at the same time are very tiny and they can be easily inserted inside the helmet. And last but not least, we wanted also to avoid completely the usage of cables. So we want give an energy autonomy, inserting an onboard battery, and we want to transmit data from the helmet to the PC wireless, so via Bluetooth.
During our project, we were able then to realize a working prototype of our product. And in order to do that, we merged the different competencies we have in different fields of engineering, starting from a structural analysis of the helmet to understand what its behavior in case of an impact. And moreover, the structural analysis was very useful for the determination of the sizing of the sensing system, in the sense that we used simulations in order to have information related to the number and position of sensors that are necessary to obtain complete data about all the possible dangerous impacts that can occur in all the points of the head. After doing that, we were able to actually design the sensing system. So we went through the choice of the components to be integrated on board. We assembled the system and we finally integrated all the system inside the sample helmet. Another important part of our project was related to the software development, in the sense that we developed a graphic user interface to allow users to manage and analyze their data in a user-friendly environment. So we start from the structural behavior of helmets. First, a brief introduction on the constitution of helmets that are usually made of two different materials, two different layers of two different materials. There's an outer shell made of polycarbonate whose main role is to spread the region in which the impact involves high acceleration levels. In that way, the acceleration peak is reduced overall. On the other hand, the inner shell made of expanded polystyrene absorbs part of the energy of the impact, and so it allows the helmet to transmit a lower amount of energy to the head, thus reducing the level of danger of the impact for the head. So in order to carry out the simulations, we took a European standard as a model, and this European standard is in particular used to test and validate helmets. And so we simulated the same exact situation by putting a dummy head inside the helmet and by making the system impact on a proper impactor. In particular, we carried out dynamic simulations using the finite element method. This slide is, allows us to understand what's the damping, the damping capability of helmets. So we simulated the impact of the system against the impactor, and we analyzed the stress, the principal compressive stress field. And you can see from this graph here on the right that the helmet does its job properly in the sense that it dumps down the impact, lowering by more than an order of magnitude the acceleration peaks from the external part compared to the internal part. So for example, the violet curve corresponds to point A at the border between the polycarbonate and the EPS and the external part of the helmet, and you can see the acceleration peak is as high as 5,000 G, while instead in the dummy head, the acceleration is reduced by to 500 G, so by approximately one order of magnitude. But as I said before, we also used numerical simulations in order to determine the sizing of the system. So if, as in the number of sensors needed, if the helmet was a completely rigid system, only one sensor will be enough to detect all the possible impact that can occur on all the surface of the device. While we verified by simulation that when an impact occurs, the maxima stress fields are confined to a small region around the collision point. So more than one sensor is needed. Otherwise, for example, if the sensor is far away from the collision point, we will not be able to detect the acceleration peak. So we came out with a solution featuring five accelerometers that is valid in the sense that we verified by simulation that even if the collision point is very far from the sensors, we are able to detect an acceleration peak and so to detect all the possible dangerous impact that can occur on the surface of the helmet. After carrying out the simulations, we were able then to define the number of sensors needed, which are five linear accelerometers, and we were able to start designing effectively our system. So the first important choice we had to make was related to the kind of sensor to be used, which have to be cheap, they have to be accurate, they have to provide a fast enough sampling frequency in order to record the impact, the peaks that have a duration of milliseconds, and moreover, they have to be small enough to be integrated in an embedded system. So the perfect candidate for that were MEMS sensors, as my colleague mentioned before, which we use for the accelerometers. Moreover, we integrated on board a Bluetooth module to allow the wireless communication to the PC of the data. But the most important, probably, component in this board is the microcontroller, which allows to manage the behavior of the sensors, because the sensors alone, of course, cannot be managed properly. So we use the microcontroller, which is basically a small computer, which is commonly used in embedded applications. And you can customize the behavior of the microcontroller in the sense of how it manages the sensors and the peripherals connected to it, by developing a special software called firmware that can be customized by the user. Moreover, we integrated the possibility of saving the data related to impacts on board, so we added a flash memory on board. To avoid completely the amount the usage of cables in our system, we also adopted a strategy that allows to recharge wirelessly the onboard batteries. So we use an inductive charging method, which is already commonly quite widespread in the field of smartphones, for example. So finally, we were able to insert our system inside the helmet. And in particular, the positions of the sensor were was exactly the same position that was simulated to be valid thanks to the finite element method. Going into more details, our system was designed to work in two different working modes. Since the sports that can be targeted by the product can be divided into two subgroups, there are sports like American football and ice hockey in which the impact occur very frequently and they don't have a very large intensity usually. But it's important for the sideline staff and for the coach to monitor in real time what's happening to the athlete. So for this sport, our system is able to send, to detect the impact and to send the data in real time to a PC to allow the real time monitoring. On the other hand, our system can work in a different mode for sports like alpine skiing or cycling, in which the impacts are more rare in a way, but when they happen, they're usually more severe. And in this case also, you don't have in close proximity to the athlete a device that can monitor in real time usually the impact. So we added for this sport the possibility to save the data related to impacts on board in the flash memory, and only later on the data can be downloaded to a PC in order, for example, to help the medical staff to intervene in a more effective way. We also developed, as I mentioned before, the graphic user interface to allow the management of data. We used the object-oriented programming language Python. And in particular, of course, like this software has to comply with the different working modes. So it's able to work correctly both in real-time mode and in flash mode. On the other hand, it provides very detailed data about the impacts that occur in terms of the acceleration history in the 5 points corresponding to the different accelerometers. And moreover, it provides provides resuming data about the impacts like the maximum acceleration and mean acceleration and so on. Finally, we also performed a test of our prototype that was successful in the sense that the prototype could correctly record the acceleration in all the different points when it was made to impact on a surface. And in addition to that, we also used this test to validate the numerical model used for the simulation before to understand that it gave coherent results. So we reproduced the same exact situation in the numerical model, and we compared the acceleration peaks. The solid line here corresponded to the experimental acceleration, while the dotted lines correspond instead to the simulated accelerations. And from the qualitative point of view, these two peaks are rather in good agreement, while you have to say that there is quite a big discrepancy in the post-peak region. And we attributed that to approximation that we had to introduce in the numerical model. But still, we in a way found a rather good agreement. So to sum up, we have targeted this potentially successful solution, that is the construction of a product that detects impacts and provides data about them in different sports. We developed the product as an embedded solution so that the users don't have to buy additional equipment to obtain information about the impacts. And we were able to design a solution that is suitable to different sports, both contact sports and both sports like alpine skiing and cycling. And in particular, we worked using different disciplines of engineering to realize a working prototype. Still, this prototype has to be made a bit more robust and has to be validated more in depth. But once we will be able to do that, we can then have a product that can be sold to helmet producers in order to integrate it inside helmets of different sports in order to allow the athletes to enjoy their activity in a safer way. So I thank you for your attention. Of course, we'll be pleased to answer your questions. Thank you.